will you vote Saul, seeing I rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and gold. I'm sending you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided myself a kingdom among his sons." And Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears it, he will kill me." But the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Then invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. You shall anoint for me the one I name to you." So Samuel did what the Lord said and went to Bethlehem. And the elders of the town trembled at his coming and said, "Do you come peaceably?" And he said, "Peaceably I come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourself to come with me to the sacrifice." Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. So it was when they came, they looked at Eliab and said, "Surely the Lord's anointing is before me." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." So Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Thus Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen these." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all the young men here?" Then he said, "Every man, yet the youngest. There he is, keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." So he sent and brought him in. And he was ready with bright eyes and good looking. And the Lord said, "Arise, anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel arose and went around. And we will use for a subject for this morning. God doesn't choose the qualified. He qualifies those he chooses. You may be saying, God does not choose the qualified. He qualifies those he chooses. Lord God, right now, as we embark going deep into what your word has to say, in the 16th chapter, verse 8. I pray right now, Lord, you will allow me to share with accuracy, clarity, depth, and truth what thus saith God. Anoint me in your presence, saturate me in your spirit, that I may proclaim your word to your people on this day. Forgive me of anything and everything I may have said, thought, done, or looked at that's contrary to your word. For I will nothing but hinder your word going forward in strength and power and your anointing. For it is in Jesus Christ's name that I pray and give thanks. Amen. Amen. Ushers, you may be seated. If you had had heart surgery and you could choose to have your surgery performed by a surgeon that graduated 60 of 60 people in his class, or you could choose to have the one ranked first, most, if not all, people would prefer to have their surgery performed by the one ranked first. If you were the general manager of a professional football team, and you had the one overall pick in the draft, and you needed a quarterback or you needed a defensive lineman, you probably draft the person who was top ranked on your draft board for that position of need for your team. You see, in business and in sports, that is how it works. And really, that's how it's supposed to work. But in God's economy, that is not how it works. God will not tolerate pride.
Amen.
Matter of fact, in Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 to 19, there lists six things God says he hates. And the very first thing God says that he hates is pride. Now, since God will not tolerate pride, he chooses people to do his work that have nothing to brag about. You see, all of us, every last one of us, was born in sin, shaped in iniquity at birth. We were born with a head-on collision to eternity in hell. It takes God's grace, God's mercy, God's forgiveness, and his him choosing us for us to be saved.
Amen.
And then used by him for kingdom advancement. So if you are saved, it does not matter what you receive in the weeks to come under the Christmas tree.
Amen.
You have a reason to rejoice if you are saved. Because God chose you before the foundations of the earth, of this world, to be saved despite our flaws. Now, if God only chose people with few character flaws, some, if not all, of the credit would go to that person and not to the Lord. So God oftentimes chooses the ignored. The one who looks like they would never amount to anything.
All right.
By choosing flawed people with a bad past, with a shaky present, and with an uncertain future, God alone gets the glory when we accomplish amazing things in his power.
Amen.
The talent pool for the Lord had always been pretty thin, y'all. Throughout the ages, as it relates to moral perfection, yes, flawed people have been used by God to change the world. So if you ever felt overlooked, if you ever felt unworthy, if you think your past or your present is too dark for God to use you, let me tell you something. You are in great company. Consider the roll call of those who God used as imperfect heroes to do great things. Noah was a drunk. Abraham lied about his wife. Jacob was a shyster and a deceiver. Moses was a murderer. He murdered an Egyptian. Rahab was a prostitute, a harlot. Samson had serious lust and anger issues. Miriam was a gossiper. Praise the Lord. A whole lot of people could be happy now. Gideon was insecure and afraid. Paul was first Saul, who persecuted the church and then had Christians killed. And the key person in our sermon text this morning, David, was an adulterer. And he was a conspiracy artist, for he conspired to have Uriah, the husband of the woman he committed adultery with, killed. So we in good company as it relates to being flawed people, but yet God still desires to choose us to do his work. Our 2017 theme reflects the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. But I want you to know God desires to use all of us for his glory if we surrender our life to his will. If we repent of our sins, God has a place for all of us to serve. So with the text of the Holy Spirit as my guide, I'd like to briefly share with you three object lessons regarding the subject. God doesn't choose the qualified. He qualifies those he chooses. Object lesson number one. God sovereignly chooses some people that may be rejected by me. Mm-hmm. Yes. Now, first of all, let me provide you just a little brief background to our sermon text. After God delivers the children of Israel by sovereignly raising up Moses, again, Moses was a former first degree murderer. But God raises up Moses, and by his grace and mercy, Moses leads the Jewish people out of slavery. But they gripe and they complain. Therefore, they wander in the wilderness for 40 years. So God sovereignly raises up Joshua to lead them to destroy 7 different nations, and God took their land and gave it to the Israelites perpetually, forever. That's the reason why there's a Middle East crisis to this day, is because that very land is the land that God gave to the Israelites that the ungodly people don't want Israel to have. Now, this took about 450 years, and then after that, judges ruled Israel until the time of Samuel the prophet. The Jewish people, they eventually reject Samuel. But really, they're not rejecting Samuel, because Samuel was called by God. They're really rejecting God. And they ask for a king to be just like the other nations around them. God warned them that elevating a man to be their king would bring political corruption and trouble. But the people rejected God's advice, and they were staunch about the fact that they wanted a king like the rest of them. So God allowed them to have just what they were asking for. They gave King Saul. Now Saul started off doing wonderful things. On the surface, he was tall, he was strong, he was just the man for the job. But see, when you do anything that God has had a different plan for the people, which was for him to be their God, instead of a king to be their God. Anytime we go against God's plans, it's not going to be good that's going to work out of it initially, unless there's some repentance that takes place. Because God can work through our mess and create blessings. And I don't know about you, but I've made a mess before, I've made a mistake before, but God, because of his grace and mercy, could work through that. So 1 Samuel chapter 16 then tells us, because Saul engaged in the occult, meaning he engaged in witchcraft. Saul disobeyed God to the degree that 1 Samuel chapter 16 verse 1, the first part of it says, "Now the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul after I've rejected him from reigning over Israel?" This leads us to something that we better all recognize. If you reject God, eventually God will reject you. Let me shut that corner down to the cow a little further. If you live in open rebellion against the word of God, eventually you're going to reap what you sow. You are just not going to tell God that I'm going to live this lifestyle despite what your word says. I'm going to shack up because that's what I want to do. I'm going to live a homosexual life because that's what I want to do. I'm not going to be breaking down so it gets to all of us. I'm not going to give Christmas time and Thanksgiving because there's too many presents I got to buy. God, I'll catch up on it in January and February. See, we can't live in open rebellion against the word of God and then expect God to shower down his best and his choices, blessings to us. What happens is when we reject God, he will reject us eventually. And the saddest verse, one of the saddest verses in the Bible that the pastor must remind the people about every week is Hebrews 9 and 12. It is appointed to man to die once. After that comes the judgment. So if you die and have not made peace with God by accepting him while you are alive, there is no other opportunity. That's why if we have unsaved people in our family, this is why I push shout so hard. It is because there's a segment of prayer that we cry out for the unsaved. Let me tell you something. There is nobody but God can turn around somebody who don't want God in their life. It is nothing you will want to be able to say or do that's going to change the heart of somebody that right now is against God.
Amen.
Church, God's choices are sovereign choices with sovereign planning and sovereign power. This means God knows everything. He knew Saul was going to be disobedient. God had to allow the people to see for themselves that Saul was not the man for the job so that they would then be supported and embrace God's plan. See, that's what God will do with us. He'll let us go off on the reservation doing our own thing for a season. For a season, you know. But if you're God's property, eventually you're going to get called back. He's going to bring some storms. He's going to bring some trials. He's going to bring some tribulations. He's going to bring whatever he has to bring in your life to get your attention that you're on the wrong path. God knew something else, and we're going to discuss in this text, that his choice was not going to line up with human expectation. Look at the latter part of verse 1. It says, fill your heart with oil and go. I am sending you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided myself a king among your sons. Samuel is told exactly where to go find a new king for the Lord, because God had been arranging to bring his chosen king into the world at precisely the right time in history.
Amen.
See, sometimes because we're so impatient with God, we want to go out and do things our way. Sometimes what God has to do with all of us is he got to put us all on the polished wheel for a season. He got to shape us. He got to mold us. He got to rub off some meanness and rub off some angry, rub because if we go out in the way that he first finds us, we gonna fail.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you look back at the ancestry of King David, you will find the hand of God was moving and shaping events in his life. One of David's ancestors was a woman named Rahab. Judges chapter 2 lets us know Rahab had been saved out of pagan idolatry, have been brought into the nation of Israel. This woman was a harlot and a prostitute, but yet God saw fit to bring something great through her name. Don't you look down on nobody and say what God can do. Rahab married a man named Salmon. This is found in Matthew chapter 1, verse 5. Matthew chapter 1 gives us the genealogy of Jesus. And they had a son named Boaz. Boaz married a Gentile girl, brought out of paganism, and brought into sovereign grace of the Lord. Her name was Ruth, according to the 4th chapter of Ruth. Ruth and Boaz were the great-grandparents of a boy named David. So these events were not accidental. They were a part of a perfect plan formulated in eternity past, but worked out in time at the mighty hand of the Lord. God's choices not only involve sovereign plan, but also sovereign power. Notice the words I am and I have spoken by God in verse 1. Many people have great plans and great dreams, but they lack the power to bring them to pass. You can say you want to do whatever you want to do, but if it isn't God's will for you to do it, if he don't give you the means and the way to do it, you will not do anything God don't desire for you to do if he chooses you not to do that. So it takes his sovereign planning and his power. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9 affirms this when it says a man's heart plans his way, but it is the Lord who directs his steps. Church, whatever God proposes, he is well able to dispose. Wherever God guides, he always provides. Now look again at verses 2 to 5 real quick. It says, and Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hears, he gonna kill me. But the Lord said, take a heifer with you. Now this heifer is an animal. This is a cow. Y'all catch that? You get it? And say, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Then invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. You shall anoint for me the one I named in you. So Samuel did what the Lord said, and went to Bethlehem, and the elders of the town trembled at his coming, saying, you become a piece of. And he said, peacefully I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourself and come with me to the sacrifice. Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. These were dangerous times for Samuel. Saul would kill anybody who talked about that they were the king or the next king. So God's plan was for Samuel to go to Jesse's house and conduct a sacrificial worship service, which would not cause any concern, raise any red flags to anybody, including King Saul. And note this, before God uses you, he must cleanse you from unrighteousness. He must consecrate you and set you apart from the masses. See, in our day and age, many Christians are trying to blend in. But God is calling Christians to stand out. Notice verse 4 says, Samuel did what the Lord said. Let me tell you something. If you don't get nothing else out of this message, understand this statement. Obedience is the pathway to blessing. Obedience is the pathway to favor with God, and it's the pathway for God's anointing. I'm still amazed at how people expect God to answer their prayers, yet they want to live in open rebellion against the word of God. Church, God's sovereign choices, they extend to every area of your life. God cannot be compartmentalized. You can't bring him out on Sunday when you come here, but then you want to hide Monday through Saturday. Now, I don't presume to understand all of God, how he does his sovereign choices, but I believe what the Bible teaches us. God is in the business of working out things according to his will for our good and for his glory. As stated in Romans 8 and 28. Now, some people are bothered by the notion that God is in absolute control of all of life. But I'm going to tell you something. I find that very comforting. Because I know nothing can happen to me unless God ordains it. You can plot, plan to do whatever you want to do against me, but you can't do nothing that God don't allow. If God ordains it and allows it, then that also means this. It means that it's for my good and for his glory. So my question needs to be, when I'm in a trial, when I'm going through something, I don't understand the question, that needs to be, why me, Lord? The question needs to be, Lord, what are you trying to show me? What are you trying to teach me? What aspect of my character are you working on? What part of the potter's wheel do you have me on now? See, we just had a presidential election, and I've never seen so many Facebook posts where people act like the world is about to come to an end. Folks act like the world is over, and people are acting like, oh, woe is me. We don't know what we're going to do, what we're going to do, what we're going to do. But let me let y'all know something. There was no election in heaven. that's in charge of everything. And he is still Jesus. And he still is on the throne. He still rules without rival. He still makes intercession for us. He's still a provider. He's still a healer. He's still a way out of no way. He can still overrule man's plans. Jesus still has the final say. Alright, lesson number two. Our heart condition has a direct impact on whether God will choose and use you. Now, first of all, once we mention the heart of man, we got to take Jeremiah 17 and 9 into consideration. Because Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? An unregenerate heart is wicked. An unregenerate heart thinks of doing nothing but sin. It just don't always recognize what it's doing as being sin. To be used by God, you first must go down the Roman road to salvation. And I love it when God allowed me to be able to bring this up in a message, because it is critically important that we understand this. Romans 3 and 23 says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 6 and 23 says, that the wages of sin is death. Romans 5 and 8 tells us something else. It says, but God demonstrated his own love toward us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 10 and 9 says, but God, it says, if we confess rather with our mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in our heart God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. That is a road we all must pass and travel through in order for our hearts to be accepted by God. Although saved people still commit sin daily. Let me say that again. Although saved people still commit sin daily. But when saved people sin, we have the Holy Spirit that convicts us and convinces us that we must confess of our sin, then we repent of our sin, then we are restored in proper fellowship with the Lord, then we are repositioned for God to use us. Saved people are ever striving to be more like Jesus. So don't think God rejects the seven brothers and then chooses David because David was sin-free. Now look closely at verses 6 to 10. It says, so it was when they came and he looked at Eliab and said, surely the Lord anointed is before him. But the Lord said to Samuel, don't look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees, for a man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. So Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel, and he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, neither hath the Lord chosen this one. Thus Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. There were three factors in Bethlehem that composed of having seven more physically alluring young men than Jesse. Yet none of them was God's chosen king. Many may have looked at their faces and their form and their stature, but according to verse 7, God examined their hearts. And with God, it's always a matter of the heart. You see, only God can know our real motive, why we want to lead. Only God can know our real motive as to why we want to serve. Only God can know why we really want to be on the program. And I'm so glad God does not make his choices for his favor and for those he will use like the world does. Our sermon passage, especially verse 7, should challenge us to change the way we look at ourselves. Change the way we look at others. There is a vast difference between our view of beyond the call of duty. There's some that get it.
said the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray to the Lord of the harvest to send laborers into his field. We better be careful how we assess those around us. Don't you reject those whom God raises up and sends to us. God oftentimes passes over the ones others would choose, wouldn't choose. God calls those we would have never imagined. God excels in taking nobodies and making somebodies out of them. When God went after a man after his own heart, he did not go to the palace. He did not go to the temple. He did not go to the place of wealth and power and influence. God chose the most unlikely person in the most unlikely of places. A key to being used by God, church, is this: being reliable and being available. There's a lot of people have a whole lot of talents in every church there is. They're some of the most gifted people on planet Earth. But many of them do not use any of that talent and gift that came from the Lord in the house of God. Let me tell you something. God did not give you all of your talent, your skills, so that they can be used just for your job, just for your sorority, just for your fraternity. He gave them for you to use them inside of the house of prayer also. You will have to give an account to God for what you did with what he gave you. Remember these people folk with all these talents? One buried it. Other one took his five and made five more. So in other words, what he did, he invested it into what he was called to do. So when God gives you a talent, invest what he gives you into somebody else, and then he can trust you with another one. But too many of us are burying our talent. We're content with just coming to church on Sunday, and that's it. I did my religious thing for the day. I was a church. I call mom, I call my daddy, I call somebody to tell them I'm with the church today. It's a church in you, though. This is a building. This is 401 West Urban. This can blow, burn up, blow up anything, but the church ain't gonna stop because this building don't exist. The church is saved saints. And saved saints are sinners saved by grace. Too many people want to do great things in the church, things whereby they are highlighted for doing something, but they are not reliable and available in doing the main thing. What's the main thing, Pastor? I'm so glad you asked that question. We were created to worship. We are called to pray without ceasing. We are called to study this Bible to show ourselves approved. Look at the money in some cute little something we just put together to have something in the church. It's a way of iron, sharpening iron. It's for us to read his word, study his word, so that his Bible will become our final authority over all matters of our lives. We're called to give as God has given to us. Boy, I know. I'm not gonna speak this into existence, but I'm gonna say this. Quite often when you get to this time of the year, the giving in the church get mighty sleep.
All
right. Let me tell you something. I would never, and I do it for practice. I don't care if anybody pick up the phone and call Sandra or call Darren and say, "Did Pastor really give like he say he give?" Let me tell you something. I will never not give to the Lord to go buy anything for nobody else if I haven't first given to the Lord.
Amen.
First. Is God. Your checkbook lets you know what's first in your life. When I get paid, first thing I pay is my grace giving. Second thing I pay is my capital campaign. And I praise God, he leaves enough left over to go pay some bills. Praise the Lord. We are to give as God has given to us. We are called to go make disciples. We are then called to disciple the same. We're called to not get the assembly of ourselves. We're called to serve. If you want to be used by the Lord, let me encourage you, be faithful right where you are.
Amen.
Bloom where you have been planted. Be available and reliable where you never know when the call of God is going to come. And God knows exactly where to find you. Notice, when they had the conversation, Samuel's like, well, wait a minute, now you rejected all seven of these. Now God told me that I'm going to anoint the right one from here. There's got to be another one. So God knew David was out there. Let me say this to you. It might look like nobody don't see you right now. It might look like you've been overlooked on your job right now. It might look like you're not going to get a promotion. It might look like you're not going to make it through. But God knows right where you are. He's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above what we can ask, think, or imagine. And finally, as I rush to a close here, I want you to notice the fact David was, in essence, the eighth son. See, eight in scripture numerically means a new beginning. God was going to use David to bring about a new beginning in Israel, both governmentally and spiritually. God is ready to bring a new beginning in your life. It does not matter how long you have sat in church and not served. It doesn't matter if you have allowed Satan to make you use your talents and gifts for everybody but the Lord. God is ready to give you your assignment and empower you to do great things for kingdom advancement if you are ready to repent. If you will make yourself available to the Lord, and you will know that you are chosen when that which God is calling you to do make you feel unqualified to do it. When you say, Lord, I can't do this, when you feel almost terrified to go forward, you must know God does not choose people who think they already know how to do everything or feel they're the only one who can do it. God's plans are always God's size. His plans will make you cry out, Father, I stretch out my hands to thee, but there's no other help that I know. God will then say to that one, he will say, I chose you because when you accomplish what I called you to do in my strength, you will say it was nobody but the Lord. You will say, I'm standing here today because, Lord, you made way. When doors start opening for you out of nowhere, you will give all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory to the Lord. That's why when you hear the choir sing songs about thank you, Lord, you'll reflect back on what he's done. You'll reflect back on the doors he's opened. You'll reflect back on the people he's placed in your life. Thank you, Lord. We're called for such a time as this. And the real question for the church is, will we have that spiritual inventory to meet the manifold needs of the people in our spirit influence? And you can rest assured that we will realize this when we realize God doesn't choose the qualified. He qualifies those in Jesus. Let us pray. Amen. Mighty and everlasting. I thank you that you chose me before the foundations of the earth. You chose me first out of darkness into the marvelous light. Then you chose me from the chosen to be a minister. Then you chose me from those who were called to be ministers to be the pastor of the King First Baptist Church. Lord, I thank you for the privilege and the honor you have bestowed upon me. Now, Lord, I pray if there be any in this house who may have felt like they've been left out, that people have put them down and made them think that they can't do. I pray right now that you would meet them right at their point of need. Minister to them right now so that they may give their life to you and say, Lord, I surrender my will for your will. For it is in Jesus Christ's name that I pray and I give thanks. Amen. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Oh, Deacons, ministers, and counselors, would you please join me? If you are here today and you're searching for a church home, or you may just want to be on the watch care, today is a great day to get up and say, Lord, I'm coming to be a part of a church where the Bible.